the identity of God. Who is God? In your attempt to define God, did you ever stop to consider some of the words you were using? Did you pause and reflect on the deep meaning of the words? If you did, you probably realized that these mere words failed to capture God's essence. And this is, as you would expect, finite beings using natural words to describe a supernatural being leads to the use of words we do not comprehend. In other words, words have a limit because they come from finite beings with finite minds. They are inadequate for the task. You therefore devise or learn words you really have no experiential grasp of. For example, you may have listed that God is eternal. Do you have any idea of what eternal experientially means? You can read about the color, but until you actually see it, you will have no idea what it looks like. Or you can read a lot about cycling, but have a little idea of what cycling is, unless you have ridden a bike. No human being has any idea what eternity is like. You cannot comprehend it. You can try to think about it, but will inevitably get lost in the repeating of never-ending, never-ending, never-ending. No finite created being with a definite beginning and a definite end can grasp a concept that has no beginning or end. All you can do is to apprehend its awesomeness, its holy otherness, its total beyond you-ness. How do you feel when you think of God as wholly beyond you in every conceivable way? Are we struck, confused, distant? Hopefully you are beginning to feel just how big God is. My hope for you is that you never lose that feeling, a depth of God inspired awe as long as you live. My prayer for you is to continue to seek to go deeper into God's identity until the only way you can best describe Him is simply God is. Hear the following definition of God given by Gordon Lewis. God is an invisible, personal, and living spirit, distinguished from all other spirits by several kinds of attributes. Metaphysically, God is self-existent, eternal, and unchanging. Intellectually, God is omniscient, faithful, and wise. Ethically, God is just, merciful, and loving. Emotionally, God detests evil, is long-suffering, and is compassionate. Existentially, God is free, authentic, and omnipotent. Rationally, God is transcendent in being, immanent universally in providential activity, and immanent with His people in redemptive activity. Yan ang sabi ni Gordon Lewis. By no means memorize this definition. For most of us, this definition is far too academic. The reason it is here to underscore the problem of finite beings trying to define the infinite. The smarter you are, and Gordon Lewis is smart, the bigger words you will use to describe God until most of the words lose experiential meaning. Definitions of the trickier words are given below, but remember the best way to get to know God or anyone else for that matter is to experience Him and be in His presence. Remember, this definition is designed to leave you saying wow or feeling the weight of God's awesomeness, vastness, beyond meanness. It is not supposed to be comprehended, but for sake of explanation here is what some of the words refer to. Metaphysically, fundamental nature of reality and being, long-suffering, slow to anger, patient endurance of being wronged. Existentially, how you experience reality, transcendent, beyond you. A few of the names in the list may not make any sense to you, even you hear what I said. This is because it's a name that is probably tied to a cultural issue or concern that was popular at the time or native to Middle East culture, but not here. You may choose to research that name or leave it for another time and just let the ones you recognize understand to sink in. The names of God. Let's begin in the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, there are names for God. Elohim. Genesis 1:1, Psalm 19:1, meaning God, a reference to God's power and might. Adonai, Malachi 1:6, meaning Lord, a reference to the Lordship of God. Jehovah Yahweh, Genesis 2:4, meaning God's divine salvation. Jehovah Makadishim, Exodus 31:13, meaning the Lord my sanctifier. Jehovah Rohe, Psalm 23:1, meaning the Lord my shepherd. Jehovah Shammah, Ezekiel 40:35, meaning the Lord who is present. Jehovah Rapha, Exodus 15:26, meaning the Lord our healer. Jehovah Chidkino, Jeremiah 23:6, meaning the Lord our righteousness. Jehovah Jireh, Genesis 22, 13-14, meaning the Lord will provide. Jehovah Nisi, Exodus 17:15, meaning the Lord our banner. Jehovah Shalom, Judges 6:24, meaning the Lord is peace. Jehovah Zabaoth, Isaiah 6, 1-3, meaning the Lord of hosts. El Elyon, Genesis 14, 17-20, Isaiah 14, 13-14, meaning the Most High God. El Roe, Genesis 16:13, meaning the strong one who sees. El Shaddai, Genesis 17:1, Psalm 19:1, meaning the God of the mountains or God Almighty. El Olam, Isaiah 40, 28-31, meaning the everlasting God. More names of God, Abba or Daddy, Romans 8:15. Advocate, 1 John 2:1. Almighty, Psalm 68:14. Alpha, Revelation 22:13. Amen, Revelation 3:14. Ancient of Days, Daniel 7:9. Anointed One, Psalm 2:2. Apostle, Hebrews 3:1. Arm of the Lord, Isaiah 53:1. Author of Life, Acts 3:15. Author of our faith, Revelation, Hebrews 12:2. Beginning, Revelation 21:6. Blessed and Holy Ruler, 1 Timothy 6:15. Branch, Jeremiah 33:15. Bread of God, John 6:33. Bread of Life, John 6:35. Bridegroom, Isaiah 62:56. Bridge Morning Star, Revelation 22:16. Chief Shepherd, 1 Peter 5:4. Chosen One, Isaiah 42:1. Christ, Matthew 22:42. Christ of God, Luke 9:20. Christ the Lord, Luke 2:11. Christ, Son of the Living God, Matthew 16:16. Comforter, John 14:26. Commander, Isaiah 55:4. Consolation of Israel, Luke 2:25. Consuming Fire, Deuteronomy 4:24. Cornerstone, Isaiah 28:16. Counselor, John 14:26. Creator, 1 Peter 4:19. Deliverer, Romans 11:26. Desired of all nations, Haggai 2:7. Door, John 10:7. And Revelation 21:6. Eternal God, Deuteronomy 33:27. Everlasting Father, Isaiah 9:6. Faithful and True, Revelation 19:11. Faithful Witness, Revelation 1:5. More names of God, Father, Matthew 6:9. Firstborn, Romans 8:29. First Fruits, 1 Corinthians 15:23. Foundation, 1 Corinthians 3:11. Friend of Tax Collectors and Sinners, Matthew 11:19. Gentle Whisper, 1 Kings 19:12, gift of God, John 4:10, glory of the Lord, Isaiah 45, God, Genesis 1:1, God Almighty, Genesis 17:1, God over all, Romans 9:5, God who sees me, Genesis 16:13, God good shepherd, John 10:11, great high priest, Hebrews 4:14, great shepherd, Hebrews 13:20, guide, Psalm 48:14, head of the body, Colossians 1:18, head of the church, Ephesians 5:23, heir of all things, Hebrews 1:2, high priest, Hebrews 3:1, high priest forever, Hebrews 6:20, holy one, Acts 2:27, holy one of Israel, Isaiah 49:7, Holy Spirit, John 16:26, hope, Titus 2:13, horn of salvation, Luke 1:69, I am, Exodus 3:14, John 8:58, image of God, 2 Corinthians 4:4, image of His person, Hebrews 1:3, Emmanuel, Isaiah 7:14, Jehovah, Psalm 83:18, Jesus, Matthew 1:21, Jesus Christ, our Lord, Romans 6:23, Judge, Isaiah 33:22, King, Zechariah 9:9, King Eternal, 1 Timothy 1:17, King of Kings, 1 Timothy 6:15, King of the Ages, Revelation 15:3, Lamb of God, John 1:29, Last Adam, 1 Corinthians 15:45, Lawgiver, Isaiah 33:22. Leader, Isaiah 55:4, Life, John 14:6, Light of the World, John 8:12, Like an Eagle, Deuteronomy 32:11, Lily of the Valleys, Song of Solomon 2:1, Lion of the Tribe of Judah, Revelation 5:5, Living Stone, 1 Peter 2:4, Living Water, John 14, Lord, John 13:13, Lord God Almighty, Revelation 15:3, Lord Jesus Christ, 1 Corinthians 15:57, Lord of all, Acts 10:36, Lord of glory, 1 Corinthians 2:8, Lord of lords, 1 Timothy 6:15, Lord our righteousness, Jeremiah 23:6, love, 1 John 4:8, man of sorrows, Isaiah 53:3, master, Luke 5:5, mediator, 1 Timothy 2:5, merciful God, Jeremiah 3:12, messenger of the covenant, Malachi 3:1, Messiah, John 4:25, mighty God, Isaiah 9:6, mighty one, Matthew 2:23, mighty one, Isaiah 60:16, Nazarene, Matthew 2:23, offspring of David, Revelation 22:16, Omega, Revelation 22:13, only begotten son, John 1:18, our Passover lamb, 1 Corinthians 5:7, our peace, Ephesians 2:14, Pater, Isaiah 64:8, power of God, 1 Corinthians 1:24, Prince of Peace, Isaiah 9:6, Prophet, Acts 3:22, Purifier, Malachi 3:3, Rabboni or Teacher, John 20:16, Radiance of God's Glory, Hebrews 1:3, Redeemer, John 19:25, Job 19:25, Refiner, Refines Fire, Malachi 3:2, Resurrection, John 11:25, Righteous One, 1 John 2:1. More names of God, Rock, 1 Corinthians 10:4, Root of David, Revelation 22:16, Rose of Sharon, Song of Solomon 2:1, Ruler of God's Creation, Revelation 3:14, Ruler over Kings of Earth, Revelation 1:5, Ruler over Israel, Micah 5:2, Savior, Luke 2:11, Scepter out of Israel, Numbers 24:17, Seed, Genesis 3:15, Servant, Isaiah 42:1, Shepherd of our souls, 1 Peter 2:25, Shield, Genesis 15:1, Son of David, Matthew 1:1, Son of God, Matthew 27:54, Son of Man. Matthew 8:20, Son of the Most High. Luke 1:32, Source Hebrews 5:9, Spirit of God. Genesis 1:2, Start out of Jacob. Numbers 24:17, Stone. 1 Peter 2:8, Son of Righteousness. Malachi 4:2, Teacher. John 13:13, True Light. John 1:9, True Witness. Revelation 3:14, Truth. John 14:6, Vine. John 15:5, Way. John 14:6, Wisdom of God. 1 Corinthians 1:24, Witness. Isaiah 55:4, Wonderful Counselor. Isaiah 9:6, Word. John 1:1, Word of God. Revelation 19:13. God's identity revealed. First, we have to deal first the absolute attributes of God. Some attributes are termed absolute because they describe what who God is in and of Himself. They are not in relationship to anything or anyone else. Spirit. God is spirit, not a spirit who does not have physical form. John 4:24. A body localizes, but God as spirit is everywhere. He cannot be limited. Although God does not have a body, He is nonetheless a substance yet not material. Spirituality goes farther than simply identifying God as not having a body. It also means that He is the source of all life. The prohibition of Exodus 24 was given because God does not have a physical form. Hence, it is wrong to make any likeness of Him. The many references to God's physical features, Genesis 3:8, 1 Kings 8:29, Psalm 34:15, Isaiah 65:2 are anthropomorphisms, figurative language giving God human characteristics so that you might understand Him better. Because God is spirit, there is a realm of reality that is present other than just the realm of the physical. We call this the spiritual realm, and it is just as real as the physical. Not only that, the spiritual realm existed before the physical realm was ever created. In one sense, it is more real than the physical realm. God the Creator existed before the material the created. So when the Bible talks about angels, demons, and the spiritual aspect of humans, it is real and not some mythical, magical, or fantastical element in Scripture. The spiritual world needs to be taken just as seriously as the physical world. Self-existence. God's self-existence means He has the ground of His existence in Himself. God is independent in His being, but also He is independent in everything else, in His virtues, decrees, works, and will. He causes everything to depend on Him. Exodus 3:14 emphasizes His self-existence and His identification. I am who I am. The verb to be emphasizes He has continual existence in Himself. John 5:26, Father, stresses that the Father has life in Himself. An unborn child is dependent on his mother for life. Animals are dependent on their surroundings for life. Trees and plants are dependent on sun and rain for life. Every living thing is dependent on someone or something else, but God is independent and existent in Himself. Daniel 5:23, Acts 17:28. Everything created is dependent on its creator. God is uncreated and therefore not dependent on anything. Immutability. Immutability is that perfection of God by which He is devoid of all change, not only in His being but also in His perfection and in His purposes and promises, and is free from all ascension or diminution and from all growth or decay. Change is always for better or for worse. But since God is absolute perfection, improvement or deterioration are impossible for Him. Malachi 3:6 teaches that the doctrine of immutability, I, the Lord, do not change. James 1:17 indicates there is no variation or shifting shadow with God. There is change throughout the world from year to year, but God does not change in His person or in his response to his creatures. The value of this doctrine is enormous, since God does not change, his love and his promises forever remain certain. His word is steady. Unity. Two thoughts are expressed in the unity of God. First, it emphasizes that God is one numerically. It was this belief that set Israel apart from her polytheistic neighbors. Part of Israel's daily worship was the recitation of the Shema, Deuteronomy 6:4, which affirmed, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one." This statement was a declaration of monotheism, affirming that God is one in his essence and cannot be divided. It also affirmed him as absolutely unique. There is none other than can be compared with him. Exodus 15:11. The emphasis on God as a numerically one is also stressed in 1 Timothy 2:5 and 1 Corinthians 8:6. Second, the unity of God stresses that God is not a composite and cannot be divided into parts. The statement stresses the inner and qualitative unity of God, because the Lord alone is God. None other is to share his glory, hence the prohibition, guard yourselves from idols. 1 John 5:21. Love. 1 John 4:8 indicates that God is love, while verse 10 explains how that love is displayed. In this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Thus, God's love may be defined as that perfection of the divine nature by which God is eternally moved to communicate himself. It is not a mere emotional impulse, but a rational and voluntary affection having its ground in truth and holiness and its exercise in free choice. Agape love is frequently used to denote God and his response to humanity. John 3:16, John 5:42, Romans 5:5 and 8, Romans 8:35 and 39, 1 John 14 and 11 and 19, and then Revelation 1:5. Agape love denotes a reason out love rather than an emotional based love, but not devoid of emotion. One that loves the object respective of the word of the object, and even though the love may not be reciprocated, it is unconditional love for one for another. Know that God is love, not just loving or lovable, because he embodies love completely and fully. There's nothing that he can do that is unloving. Think about that for a moment. All of God's actions are ultimately rooted in love. This means his wrath is also somehow rooted in love. While our minds may struggle with this, God's deepest motive for all his action is pure love. Because we cannot grasp the depth and wisdom of God, there are some things that we must accept on faith. This is one of them. Are you familiar with Romans 12:19? Do not take revenge, my friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, "It is mine to avenge, I will repay," says the Lord. Romans 2:19. Have you ever pondered this often quoted passage and wondered why it was okay for God to take revenge on someone but not you? Have you ever wondered why you were not allowed to seek vengeance? Have you ever wondered why God would teach you one thing while he would do what looked like just the opposite? If not, do so for a moment before moving on. Revenge is always a sin from a humanistic perspective. Revenge is to get even with someone. To pay back hurt for hurt, pain for pain. Its motive are always evil. So for you, revenge is always a sin. About God, why is revenge not a sin for him? It is because he is able to do revenge from a motivation of pure love. That is not something you can master up, and therefore you are prohibited from doing it. But God can and does, and therefore you can finally leave it up to him to take care of the matter. For your part, you are to love others with your actions. Also, everything God does or allows in your life is ultimately rooted in love. This is supremely mysterious, yet deeply comforting. Holiness. The basic meaning of holiness is set apart or separation. Many see holiness as the foremost attribute of all, because holiness pervades all the other attributes of God and is consistent with all he is and does. Several features are embraced in the holiness of God. It has a transcendent emphasis, indicating He is absolutely distinct from all His creatures and exalted above them in infinite majesty. Exodus 15:11 explained that in His holiness, God is without peer and awesome, revealed in the marvelous way He delivered Israel from Egyptians. Isaiah 57:15 describes His transcendence. He is high and exalted, living on a high and holy place. It also has an ethical emphasis, indicating He is separate from moral, evil, or sin. God's holiness points to His majestic purity and ethical majesty. The foundation of this emphasis is Leviticus 11:44-45. Be holy, for I am holy. Because God is morally pure, He cannot condone evil nor have any relationship to it. Psalm 11:4-6. In His holiness, God is the moral and ethical standard. He is the law. He sets the standard. He is untainted or stained from sin. Now, let's see. The other one is called relative attributes. Some attributes may be termed relative because they are related to something created. Eternal. The eternity of God is understood as God relating to time. By definition, it means that God is not limited or bound by time in any way. With God, there is no succession of events. He is above all temporal limitations. With Him, there is no distinction between the present, past, and future. But all things are equally and always present to Him. His eternity is expressed in Psalm 92, "From everlasting to everlasting, you are God." God's eternity extends backward to infinity and forward to infinity. Moreover, God's eternity is also related to His eternal role in His universal kingdom. Psalm 102:12. God's eternity is also related to His name. In Exodus 3:14, he informed Moses that His name is I Am Who I Am. Some scholars relate His name, Lord, verse 14, to I Am Who I Am. Hence, God's name reflects His eternity in that He is the continually existing one. However, this is not to suggest that time is unreal or non-existent with God. While God is everything as an eternal now, He nonetheless, in relation to humanity and the rest of creation, sees a succession of events in time. You see and experience time as linear because you are fixed to time and cannot escape it. You cannot go to the past or out into the future. You are a slave to this chronos time. But God is not. He is outside of time. He created it and He existed when there was no time. This grace was given us in Christ Jesus before the beginning of time, but it has now been revealed through the appearing of our Savior, Christ Jesus, who has destroyed death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. 1 Timothy 1:9. Paul, a servant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ, for the faith of God's elect and the knowledge of the truth that leads to godliness, a faith and knowledge resting on the hope of eternal life, which God does not lie, promised before the beginning of time, and at His appointed season He brought His word to light through the preaching entrusted to me by the command of God our Savior. Titus 1:1-3. If God is outside of time, He is in time as well, and not bound to it. Then time becomes irrelevant to Him. The past is the same as the future, which is the same as the present. He is experiencing all of your past and future simultaneously with you right now. Everything you will do, think, be, and feel is presently being experienced by God. When Genesis 1:1 says, "In the beginning God created," it includes the fourth dimension of our reality, time. Time is created element in our universe and is not itself eternal. Only God is eternal. This can have profound implications for a believer's life. One is the apparent contradiction between God's sovereignty and man's free will. That is God's divine decree or choosing us or rejecting us as our ability to choose or reject God. Praise be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For He chose us in Him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in His sight. In love He predestined us to be adopted as His sons through Jesus Christ in accordance with His pleasure and will. Ephesians 1:3-5. Now fear the Lord and serve Him with all faithfulness. Throw away the gods your forefathers worshipped beyond the river and in Egypt and serve the Lord. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your fathers served beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. Joshua 24:14-15. Immensity may be defined as that perfection of divine being by which He transcends all spiritual limitations and yet is present in every point of space with His whole being. 1 Kings 8:27, Jeremiah 23:23-24, and Acts 7:48-49. Omnipresence. In the next three attributes, the prefix omni comes from the Latin word omnis, meaning all. Thus, omnipresence means God is everywhere present. This is contrasted with pathism, which states that God is in everything. More physically, omnipresence may be defined as God in the totality of His essence without diffusion or expansion, multiplication or division, penetrates and fills the universe in all its parts. Psalm 139:7-12. Omniscience. The English word omniscience comes from the Latin word omnis, meaning all, and scientia, meaning knowledge. Thus, it means that God has all knowledge. A more comprehensive definition will state that God knows all things actual and possible, past, present, and future in one eternal act. A number of things should be noted about God's omniscience. God knows all things that exist in actuality. God knows all the variables concerning things that have not occurred. God knows all future events. Omnipotence. The term omnipotence signifies that God is all-powerful. A proper definition states, God is all-powerful and able to do whatever He wills. Since His will is limited by His nature, God can do everything that is in harmony with His perfections. In other words, the question, can God create a stone so large that He could not lift it? It's not a legitimate question. God can do all things that are in harmony with His nature and person. Truth. In speaking of God as truth, it is implied that God is all that He as God should be, and that His word and revelation are completely reliable. God is the truth in His person. God is the truth in His revelation. Mercy. A general definition of mercy is the goodness or love of God shown to those who are in misery or distress, irrespective of their deserts. A simple definition for mercy is not getting what you deserve. The Hebrew word for mercy in the Old Testament emphasizes help or kindness as the grace of a superior. The New Testament Greek word for mercy also includes the idea of pity and sympathy and may be translated as loving kindness. Justice is sometimes taken together with the righteousness of God. The justice of God means that God is entirely correct and just in all His dealings with humanity. Moreover, this justice acts in accordance with His law. Jealousy in its purest form is the desire to hold onto something precious. It is an expression of love. Lovers are jealous when their partner is giving their special deep love to another person that rightfully belongs to them. I am not talking about wanting something else for that is coveting. I am talking about the profoundly deep feeling of hurt when another receives the love that is due you. God is jealous toward you. Exodus 25, Deuteronomy 4:24, 1 Corinthians 10:22, 2 Corinthians 11:2, His bride, Revelation 19:7-21-9. When you give your love to another, anything other than God, money, power, praise, clothes, food, sex, drugs, alcohol, children, comfort, security, health, and wealth, God dreadfully deserves your love, and you're giving it to another is a blatant act of callousness and disregard His glory and majesty and honor. God's jealousy, therefore, is a beautiful display of His love for you and His desire for you to share in the intimacy of His eternal and perfect love. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, Amen.